brother. Then I am from the region of the area which is still backward. We are in the mid of, we have Totma and Serpanguri in the middle. My village is North Chimari. Then I am associated with APSU since my college days, since 2000. In the year of 2000 onwards, I am associated from my college days. Mm. So that's how I went on through actively participating in all the activities of APSU. Then right now I am holding a Assistant General Secretary of All Boro Students Union.
It's about around 50 years of struggle of demand for Bodo land. And now the talks with the government is going on. So at what stage it is happening?
The last talk which was held on 26th of April at New Delhi, it was a political level talk which was called by the Government of India. And in the presence of the Home Minister, Rajnath Singh, and then the Assam CM, and from our team, it was the movement group NDFB Progressive, as well as People's Union Action Committee for Boroland Movement, and APSU. So after that, it's the first in BJP government, the political level talk has been initiated. So this is something, a good sign for us, because the issue which has been long pending, and then the third phase of movement, which was started from 2010 by APSU, and then subsequently the ceasefire group of Progressive NDFB, they have also participated in the democratic process. So all over, again in 2011 the Joint Action Committee was formed by the NDFB Progressive. So this is a well effort that we want a concrete solution to the creation of separate state Bodoland. So in the initiative of talks, we want that the Government of India should have some pragmatic steps towards solving through dialogue and then taking policy at the government level.
The previous government, the Congress, was not very responsive for this.
Congress had brought up to the level of a bureaucratic level talks, and then the last, when Sushil Kumar Shinde was the Home Minister, he also had participated once in the talk. So that was the fourth round of talk, and then the fifth round got in with the NDA government, new government, with the bureaucratic level. So that ended with the simply of without any policy on the separate state.
I am from plain area, so the news about Bodoland,
yes,
or the representation of Bodo world,
yes,
is also by the national media,
yes,
or they call themselves national. So how do you see media helping you, or are they an obstruction to your movement?
See, media one way is helping us a lot, but sometimes when there are some incidences of violence or conflict in the region, then there is a misconception of by some group of media in the sense of understanding the Bodo community. So the Bodo community is well in movement, the local media is well aware of it. So in uprising or issues by the local media, and the media who is very much aware of the issue, it is well and done, and it is good for their representation in the media. But sometimes when violence comes or conflict is created by some sort of misgrains or underground movement groups or anything of sort, then the representation, sometimes they consider the whole of the community has to be a militant. So sometimes they fail to mention the organization of sort.
But what do you mean by local media? Assam or Bodoland media?
Even Assam also, and then outside Assam, we consider it mainstream in Indian perspective, where mainland India's media group. That's how it is.
So here the local media is also dominated by the Assamese upper caste.
Yes.
In print as well as digital. Do you see any hope or expectation from them to represent this community?
Some group of media in Assam also, although they are at the upper end of the Assamese people in Assam. So some group of media, they are very well conceptualized towards the issue, because it's a long pending issue. Assam will have a problem if this movement in rise. So it is, for them it's a problem, but when it is brought into analysis of media, some group of media place it positively, that it's a legitimate issue. So that's how we understand that certain group, definitely yes, they don't have that position of acknowledging the situation of the movement.
Do you see anyone in leadership position in media, like putting a good post in media?
Right now, we don't have a good position in media house represented by the Bodo community.
Okay.
But, there is a local media, that's a Bodo newspaper which was solely owned and edited by the Bodo owner.
Which one?
It's a Bodo Sa Daily. It's a Bodo Sa Daily from Kokrajhar. Then we had another one, but Bodoland Chansri. That's now at the halt. He is not unable to.
These are in which language?
It's in Bodo language.
Bodo language.
And another was there launched by the same publication of the Bodoland Chansri, which was the Bodoland Guardian. It's a weekly publication, but that also was not so affordable. But our media, in our own vernacular or Bodo media group, there is two or three publications which are very small in number, mm-hmm. and they have still in capacity of printing, they are very poor. So that's how in the main media what exists right now in Assam. We don't have a leader who is there holding some post of editor, chief editor, something like that. The effort that we have been trying and the idea of connecting with the large group of media house, you know, maybe from Delhi, maybe from Mumbai, or maybe in the mainland India, so-called today the national medias. So there we are because there are no correspondents sometimes, that is a problem of representing from our side. So
they have also the same problem, I think, because mainland India also have upper caste. Editor?
That
no Dalits are there,
yes.
No
Vishnu. That is one of the criteria, and they don't want to invest in artists. That is one of the idea. They don't want to invest in artists. They don't want to send a correspondent, they don't want to have a reporter, they don't want to have a media team over here, branch office or something like that. Because maybe some way they think that this area is smaller and then it's away from India. Certain issues are only for them, not for the whole of India is not affected.
What is national for them? Their nationalism does not include issues of Northeast.
That is main
people.
Media. The most issues of Northeast do not get reflected in the so-called today's national media.
And even if it will be of Assam?
Even if Assam, Nagaland, Manipur, so is the case of maybe Tripura, Arunachal, Meghalaya, it's the same.
But how long we can complain? What the community can do or what the people can...
Our option is only through some direct contacts with some journalist or the responsible person who is like sometimes been sent in the Northeast as a correspondent. So we had once one Ratnatip Chaudhary who used to come over all over Northeast, who is from Tripura, now working with NDTV. So sometimes this representation reaches when we call and there is a quite ample of opportunities taken.
And what about lawyers, in the conflict area, there are many times you need legal support, like communities need, who are living in border areas, or they need legal support because they don't have money to go to court. So how do you help them legally?
Right now, most of the legal assistance by our lawyers or our team of lawyers, particularly we are unable to give direct help to those in need of legal aid. But we sometimes assist in terms of special cases which ever comes in need of help. And then, for example, if there are some serious cases of like witch hunting or some cases of rape or sexual harassment, so those cases sometimes we particularly try to handle through our lawyers who respectively represent in the court.
So but it is there are many areas which are under AFSPA, and which place we went with, it is a place near Bhutan borders.
Yes.
So there Santhal and Bodo both are living. Sometimes there is a problem that they pick up anyone and then they land up in jail for 3 months. After 3 months they are released and they are not said what are the reason for their arrest. So how can APSU or... Because APSU is present in many places. How do you think you can reach to them and support?
First of all, we have very few lawyers. Mm-hmm. And then assisting those persons who are illegally picked up or arrested or detained. So this is a human rights perspective lawyering. Mm-hmm. And then in that sense, there is an APSPA which is in place in some areas of Assam and Bodoland region. So there are many cases which goes on and people language in the jail. So at that time, there are very few Bodo lawyers whom we cannot even name till today. There is no organization who assist. And as an APSU, we sometimes genuinely identify certain people who are very innocent and then there are ready lawyers to help. We recommend to them. So this is how we do, but we particularly are lacking lawyers and we ourselves cannot do that legal work where there are people are also very less aware of legal issues.
So those so you need to build those team of lawyers, from Bodo community itself,
yes.
and provide legal aid or how to deal with
this. We are like trying to collect, but those maximum areas wherever the region you have visited or the backward regions where even the quality of education is so poor, having a lawyer is also that difficult.
It's a luxury now.
Luxury.
And it is around 50 years, and today I saw in the stage there were hardly any women leaders. Like it was full of only men leaders from other region also, like people from Vidarbha. It is normal, usually most of the movements are, I see they are very much male dominated. So how do you relate it here? Like
our Bodoland movement, right now as you have seen practically, yes, there are no male leaders, we agree, but at times, the first base of movement, there was a women organization which represented the leadership of women. That was All Bodo Women Welfare Federation. Right now, we don't have such a group to support this movement. But we have some leaders, women leaders, who are with us, and sometimes they are unable to attend meetings because of the family issues or something where they are engaged to some teaching profession or different professions. So particularly representing by an organization or being part of this organization, the leadership of NJMB also do not have women leadership. We do have women leadership, which are secretaries. We have secretary level leadership where we have at par with the entire movement group. The representation comes mostly, like as you agree, with the male domination. So the entire movement, there is a good number of women leadership who mostly work at the grassroots. So that is what we have done.
But do you think it is also connected to the justice system or anywhere? There are many places there is patriarchy, but somehow we have a so-called idea of tribal,
yes.
That some people think they are very modern and they have gender justice more, gender equality more. So do you think that somewhere down the line in Bodo culture, women are not given equal opportunity, or there is need to do more?
Among Bodos, family or society level or the level of family life, it's okay, the status is okay with men and women. However, the political process, political movements or social movements, the women groups are there with issue-based movements sometimes, but mainly this political level movement where the representation is very low still among from the Bodo communities. Still it is a male domination of politics. There is council politics also has no men representation, and even the organization leaders whom right now the heading the movements, we have very less women leaders who are associated with the movement. So
what can be done about it?
We are already initiating the process, because last we had a separate movement by the women.
Okay.
So that's our initiative by the women leadership. And again we are going to launch another phase of movement, which will be completely led by women and headed by women, participated by women.
Okay.
And then we are going to send a delegation on issue of Bodoland to Delhi. A group of women will be representing on the issue. So it is completely on the leadership. We are trying to collect a few leadership of women, women leaders from our region. They are interested and they are already uniting each other. That is how the new initiative is coming up.
So this demand of state, suppose there is Bodoland tomorrow, and so what will be the constitution of Bodoland? What will happen to Santhal, Urao, Muslims in this region? What will be the provisions for them? Like they are already here.
See, whichever state in India, and it's an Indian diversity, it's our diversity, and say it may be a Bodoland, but every individual from different communities will have equal rights. So that's how we are fighting for the deprivation of rights for all the communities. Actually, we have a good number of Santhals, then some Orang, Mundas, who are still in the tea garden or in the forest region. So we all are the same, we are deprived. So So they will have that political opportunity of separate governance within the Bodoland. Bodoland will be a separate state. So we have will have an opportunity to look forward for all-round development of the older communities.
So, but if you see the what happened in Chhattisgarh, Uttarakhand, Jharkhand, like today leaders were giving example of Telangana also. How do you see the development happen after the state is formed? Like, there is huge level of corruption among from the local people itself. Like Shibu Soren was arrested there. In Uttarakhand, the situation is terrible.
Today, at all level of governance or maybe of business or maybe of any corporate sector, the corruption is a way of doing business. So that's how we can analyze. Okay. Other than that, it is up to the vision of the government or the people who are leading the state, the politics. It is up to them how to change and how to minimize this level of corruption. So it is still...
So you are asking for the same system?
We will have the vision of trying to end corruption, and we have that leadership who are always hoping for equal justice to all, and that we are hoping that there will be equal development and ablement without corruption. So that is
so when the demand is for the state, why not lay out the policy before what will be like policy by the APSU? Like all I hear is demand for state.
Yes,
but what after that?
So after that is like we are already internally have all the discussions with various groups of organizations, community leaders. So this initiative is there. So the same question will has been asked by these groups, that if in future Bodoland is the reality, then what will be the political strategy, the party strategy, the rule strategy, at least some laws which are going to be newly initiated by the new government or the new state. So what were the share of benefit?
Like the criticism of few people I have heard that, okay, now APSU is leading the movement, now all of them will get the power and it will be the similar thing. Like when Bodoland will form, APSU leaders will be at the top and they will be in the power and everybody else will be like that only.
That I don't think so, because there is an established political party in the region, though the BPF, though the Congress, though the BJP. It's not we who are going to have it, it's a democracy. People will have their own right of their own wish, whom to vote, which party to come into power, to bring into power. It's not we who cannot say, APSU volunteers right now cannot say that the power will own our hand. Because you see the last elections, the council election, APSU cannot take that upper hand of capturing power with any force. We are defeated. And the Lok Sabha election, it's because of our issue we have participated. And there we are defeated. So that today if people have that capacity of their wish and their participation in democracy in the electoral process, where they have the complete right to choose their leader, that is how the option is. We are open for the democratic process. So that idea is there, that yes, party representations, not absolute representations. So our idea is only to have that justice towards governing our own area, and mainly the language, culture and tradition of this Boro community who are largely...
So presently you don't think it is being preserved, like power from Guwahati is too much or what is happening now? Why, now the original question, why, what will change, like why the demand for the state? See, what is happening under the present Assam government?
The best example right now till today we have is our Boro. IAS, school inspectors, everybody recognizes it, and then they are told to open, and the government will take over after some years. So this process went on since 30 years back, but Assam government had not adopted that policy of adopting the schools as a government schools. So last initiative was done on 2011, and that law of provincialization is struck down because it is against the right to education law. And now it's a new provincialization law which has come up in Assam. So all this process, where as you believe, yes, community can establish schools. There are community established schools, you go there, they're still waiting for teachers, they're still waiting for infrastructural board, where government doesn't send a penny. But the community, how long will
it sustain? Then again, why, how long can it sustain? But there are many Bodo community who have like they have land. Okay. And they have land, they have enough money. It's I have met, no, it's just 1 or 2 day experience, but I'm just sharing that they have land. Why not they can arrange for a teacher from their own community?
See, for example, community management, EBSU once last 2 years before, when schools are without teacher, we have collected some educated guys from the local areas and kept us a teacher with a minimum pay of 1500 or 2000 in a month. This was our initiative. The villagers right now, where there are no teachers, they pay the teacher and they keep them. And this is the initiative. But how do you expect? We can't expect a rich person or a person who is having land. The land is another issue, where the people who are having large areas of land still today, the areas of land are not given the right of land. The land holding right is, in Assam we have a settlement right, we have a landholder's right, inherited right, but the settlement right is not given yet in the forest areas also. Because of that, the government has not provincialized, or the school are not being converted to government schools. That is another.
So they are saying it is illegal, or
how can they say it is illegal? Because they did not implement the forest dwellers right, which was in 2006.
So the, if suppose a community start a school, then government will not recognize it. They will
there
say
are many schools, yes. They already allowed to establish, some established in 1980, some established in 1990s. But till today, the government is reluctant of provincializing those schools. So there are people who are able enough, they have established some private schools, and all those are in some semi-urban or some exchange of cultivation or share of land where they enjoy the interest. That is how people sustain.
It is threatening for the local community, Bodo community, or how do you see it? Like, because in some places now there are like few Bodos and they are surrounded by Santals and Muslims.
Right now, if you see back relating to some conflict areas, we have that tribal belt and block in Assam, which some parts, mostly in Udalguri also, are encroached and are being already gone to the non-tribals, who are not at all eligible for the right of land over those areas. And the government has the right to evict them. Get a notice, a simple notice is enough to evict them when once they are in tribal belt and block. Assam has not done yet. So this has engulfed the encroachment in the tribal belt and block, where today you will find the Bodos are being majority, or the other tribals who are there are minority in terms of population. But there are non-tribals who have already engulfed into the areas of tribals. So that's why you find that there are some, when there is a problem with land, so there is an issue of land which comes into question, and then there is a feud among the community. So Leno borrows or Leno Bada tribes. That's why minimum interest is given.
Okay, just when people think are a borderland, they are demanding borderland. Now they are demanding Karbilong. So now they are demanding one more land. So people talk like in very loose manner about this demand of a state. What do you say to them?
Some may be ignorant about the issue. Some may not know the history of why this movement has happened. Some may not know what is the consequence of Assam movement and what the consequence of Assam effort. So why would this movement Bodoland is started and why Karbi movement is, yes, it must be for us, but it is post-independence the Karbi has been that status of earliest Sikh schedule status in the hill which they have attained soon after Meghalaya. So this is how the concept of people who don't have that idea of movement or why the people are suffering, why there is a deprivation, why there is an oppression in this region. So they don't identify the issues of oppression, suppression within the region of proposed Bodoland area, where we are still struggling to live with the identity of simple education, where people have to be educated, where we are trying hard to signify that yes, Bodo is a community or a tribe, we have its own language, culture, everything, which doesn't get a representation in the world. So if we have a separate state, then we will have that representation. The other communities also will have that equal representation, like Santals in Assam, they will not get representation until and unless there is some area where they have that conserved identity along with the Bodos or along with other communities. So this is the idea that people will be ignorant about if they don't come to understand the real fact of why we need Bodo.
This present BJP government, we have a lot of cut in education, in higher education. Now, since you are from TIS alumni, this year around 12 people are selected for from Bodo community,
yes,
to TIS.
Yes.
But now TIS has announced that SC, ST, OBC scholarship will be cut fully. So, what do you think? How these people will people from Bodo community will go study there, and this larger politics of higher education where they are cutting the fund of universities, central universities especially, where there is reservation and which leads to diversity in the campus.
So first of all, Government of India's policy of cutting the fund sanctions to the higher institutions, higher education, universities had led to this situation that once they create some fund, trying to take up the policy in order to sustain their financial benefit.